Hello everyone and welcome to Van Tech Corner. In this video, let's take a look at the NanoPi R6C from FrontierElec, and then we will check out the device performance with 1 gigabit internet plan. The NanoPi R6C can be considered the light version of the NanoPi R6S. Something new you have on this R6C is the M.2 PCIe connector. It supports NVMe SSD or wireless adapters in M.2 connector. On the board, you will have the Rockchip RK35AAS SoC. It has a high-performance CPU with 4M Cortex A76 cores that can go up to 2.4 GHz and 4M Cortex A55 cores clocked at 1.8 GHz. The Mali-G610 GPU, VPI, and NPU were also integrated into the RK35AAS SoC, which makes the NanoPi R6C capable of handling 8K video decoding and other computing and AI-related tasks. The NanoPi R6C had two variants that come with different sizes of RAM and storage. 8GB of LPDDR4 RAM with 32GB of eMMC and 4GB of LPDDR4 RAM with no eMMC. The NanoPi R6C had a 2.5Gb Ethernet LAN port that was extended from the PCIe LAN using the Realtek RTL A125BG Ethernet controller. The one port enabled gigabit Ethernet, which were directly connected to the SoC using the Realtek RTL A211F CG transceiver. Next to the network ports are the USB ports. They are USB 3.0 and a USB 2.0 hot port. Down below, you will see a USB Type-C Ura debug port. It will allow you to establish the Ura serial connection to the R6C with the CH341 USB 2.0 chip. Here, we also have the HDMI port for video output. It supports HDMI 2.1, 2.0 and 1.4 standards, with the screen's resolution go up to 8K. On the very left side of the R6C, there is a USB Type-C port for power input. It supports PD with either 5, 9, 12, and 20 volt power supply. On the rear side of the R6C, there is a mask button for firmware installation and recovery. The other side has the micro SD card slot and the reset button. On the front side, there are 4 LEDs to indicate system, WAN and LAN status. The last LED has label LED 1 and it is configurable in the OS. Now, let's open the case to see the internal components. It is very simple. You just need to unscrew 4 screws at the bottom of the R6C and then gently take out the cover. Here, we can see that the M.2 M key connectors and the M3 nut to mount an M2-2280 module, either an SSD or wireless card. If you are about to install a wireless module on the R6C, please check the connector compatibility since some of the wireless modules have key A connector. On the top left, there is the eMMC chip from 4C. This is the eMMC 5.1 chip, models A3A55, and supports up to 400 MB per second data transfer rate, or HS400. Let's remove the 4 small screws to completely take out the PCB. After remove it, just turn your R6C upright and the PCB will automatically fall down. If you still leave it upside down and use some tool to take out the board, it won't work. Taking a closer look at the PCB, we can see the RK35AAS SoC. Next to it is the 2 4GB Samsung LPDDR4X chips, model MGCL. There are also the Realtek RTL A125BG 2.5Gb Ethernet controller, and the Realtek RTL-A211 Gigabit Ethernet transceiver. On the top left of the PCB, there is a 2-pin battery connector to power the HYM-A563TS RTC chip. Down below, you will see the unpopulated 3-pin UART connector for debugging purposes. As usual, we also have the 30-pin GPIO header for SPI, UART, I2C, SPDIF, I2S, PWM, and GPIO. Now, let's assemble the case and configure the internet connection. The blue Ethernet cable is from my PC. It will be connected to the 2.5 gigabit Ethernet LAN port. The black Ethernet cable will be connected to my internet service provider Media Converter or ONT, which already in the bridge mode. Right now, the NanoPi R6C is connected to my computers, and we can see that the link speed is 2.5 gigabit per second. And right here we have an IP address from the router, and we know that the default IP is 192.168.2.1. And then let's go to 192.168.2.1 to access the NanoPi R6C dashboard. By default, the username is root and the password is password. And here we are, the NanoPi R6C running OpenWRT22, and we can see that the kernel version is 5.1.110. And right here we can see around 8 GB of RAM right here, and we do have around 32 GB of eMMC storage. So the display detected is 27.7 GB. Alright, so now let's go to network and interfaces. And by default, the one port is configured in GSCP client mode. And we can see that Ethernet 0 is the one port and Ethernet 1 is the LAN port. So right now, I'm going to configure the internet connection via PPPoE. First of all, let's click the edit button right here, and then on the protocol, I'm going to change it to PPPoE because this is the service that my ISP uses. Switch protocol, and then I will need to fill in the username and the password. Alright, so after that, let's go to the firewall and make sure that the device is assigned to the one firewall zone. GSCP server is turned off by default. So with the PPoE connection, we don't need to configure the 1.6 interface anymore, because if the ISP supports IPv6, the PPoE service will automatically configure a virtual interface. So in this case, I can just go and delete the 1.6 and let's save and apply first. So right now, for sure, we will see an error message. This is user request unknown error. And the reason is that I have yet to clone the MAC address of my one port. Currently, I'm using FPT at the internet service provider, and my provider requires the MAC address to be the same with their original router. Therefore, I will need to clone or fake the MAC address of the Ethernet 0 interface. So let's go to the devices tab right here. And right now on the Ethernet 0 right here, click on the configure button and change the MAC address right here. Alright, so this is the original MAC address from my internet service provider. So I just need to put it here and hit save. And after that, save and apply. So very simple. After we go back to the interfaces, we should be seeing the PPoE connection up and running. And right here we have IPv4 address. This is a public IP address for sure. Unfortunately, my ISP doesn't support IPv6. So in this case, I cannot find an IPv6 address. And before we proceed, let's go to the network, GSCP and DNS to configure the DNS forwarding. So I'm going to use 1.1.1.1 and 8.8.8.8. Very good, and hit save and apply. So right now the internet connection should be up and running. So let's have a quick speed test and let's see what tool we have. Alright, so let me put the speed test right here and let's run it. Very good, we are having 943 Mbps download speed, and let's wait for the upload speed. So for upload, unfortunately, we only have around 500 Mbps. And as you can see, it is now 5:37 p.m. It's a peak hour, so the traffic will not really good. And unfortunately, we only got 500 Mbps. Alright, so let us run the test again, but this time, let's check out the CPU utilization. So 192.168.2.1. Alright, so frame WRT 22.03.3. Let me run top. Let's start the test again. Alright, so we can see that with 940 Mbps, the CPU utilization is at 20% and we have around 80 or 78% idle. For updot with 460 Mbps, we have around 82% CPU idle as well. So this is the result with the default configuration. Now I'm going to turn on packet steering and then we will run the test again. And finally, we will run the test again, but with the shortwave offloading enabled. So right now we have packet steering enabled and we have full core NAT enabled. So this is the default one and I won't touch it. Let's run the test again and let's see. So with the packet steering enabled, we have more or less the same CPU utilization. It's around 22% load for 948 Mbps. And for offload, we can see more or less the same CPU uses as well. So let's go to the network firewall and turn on the shortwave flow offloading. And this time, let's check it out. Alright, so let's go. So I can see that the CPU utilization is more or less the same. We have around 20% CPU utilization with 940 Mbps throughput. With or without the shortwave offloading, it doesn't matter. Alright, so before ending the video, I'm going to run HTOP. Not sure if HTOP is available, so let's install it first and check it out. So from the test result, you can see that the CPU load share across the CPU cores. So if you don't turn on the packet steering, the load will be on one core of the CPU and it will call bottleneck or throttle sometime. Alright, so just now we set up the PVE connection and have a quick throughput test. So in your case, your ISP may use a certain VLAN on the one port, and this one is very simple. So first of all, you need to identify your WAN port, which is the Ethernet 0, and then you just need to add a new VLAN. So I will put it VLAN A02.1Q and the base device will be my WAN port right here. So let's say my internet service provider requires VLAN 1000 for the PoE connection, then I just need to create the correct VLAN right here, save, and then go to the interfaces tab and edit your WAN port and change the device to the shortwave VLAN Ethernet 0.1000 or something like that. Alright, so that's what a quick setup of the PoE connection on the NanoPi R6C. And before ending the video, let's take a look of what kinds of packages which were pre-installed on the device. So right here we have the real-time RAF, this is normal, and then we also have the net data. So this package were also pre-installed. And then we have the schedule task, kernel manager. We also have mount point to automatically mount your hard drive when it is connected to the device. Right here we have time synchronization, we have the custom command, and we have this eMMC tone. So this is a tone from Friendly Alex to flash your eMMC storage with a new OS or with a new upgrade. This is a recommend tune to perform the upgrade, alright? And on the service tab, we have Dynamic DNS, Adblock, QoS over NTAP table, bandwidth monitor, Wattcast, Smart DNS, and UPnP, alright? So we have a lot of packages pre-installed, alright? So just now we have a quick overview of the NanoPi R6C, and I'm going to end the video here. In the next one, we are going to see more in-depth testings of the R6C with my tech rig. So that's all. Thanks for watching and see you all in the next video.